नमस्कार, वेलकम टू द ई कंटेंट फॉर पोस्ट ग्रेजुएट क्लासेस एंड इनिशिएटिव ऑफ डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ हायर एजुकेशन गवर्नमेंट ऑफ मध्य प्रदेश। दिस पर्टिकुलर क्लास इज फॉर एमएससी फिजिक्स स्टूडेंट्स। टुडेज लेक्चर विल फोकस ऑन द लो एनर्जी न्यूट्रॉन प्रोटॉन स्कैटरिंग एंड स्पिन डिपेंडेंस ऑफ न्यूट्रॉन प्रोटॉन फोर्सेज। दिस टॉपिक्स कम्स अंडर द पेपर एंटाइटल न्यूक्लियर एंड पार्टिकल फिजिक्स एमएससी थर्ड सेम यूनिट फर्स्ट। I, Dr. Netram Kaurav, Assistant Professor at Government Holkar Science College, Indore, going to deliver this lecture via audio-video mode. I am thankful to Dr. Alok Rastogi, Dr. Seema Hardikar, and Dr. Mahendra Mehra for reviewing the content of this topic. As this topic is little bit advanced in nature, therefore it requires certain understanding, such as basic concept of nuclear physics, in particular nucleus and its dynamics, basic concept of quantum physics such as Schrödinger equation, solving a potential well problem, and similar many more. I am hopeful that the student will be benefited in understanding the nuclear forces by solving the scattering of nucleon by nucleons, that is neutron proton scattering, commonly known as a neutron proton scattering. Also, this lecture will help to understand the basic concept of scattering process in general. Before going to in detail of the NP scattering, let me first introduce the term scattering itself. Scattering is a very common term in condensed matter physics, quantum physics, or even in nuclear physics, wherein a change in the direction of motion of a particle because of collision with another particle takes place. We have witnessed many scattering processes in physics, such as X-ray scattering, Compton scattering, Raman scattering, neutron scattering, and many more. This figure illustrates the general idea of scattering, where an incident beam, or also called the projectile particles, is shined on a target particle, which also known as the scattering centers, and then we have scattered beam with a certain angle theta. Okay, you can see over here in this figure, this is our incident beam, this is our particle or the target material, and here you will have a scattered beam. So this scattered beam is scattered with a certain angle theta. Okay, now coming to more specific to address the scattering process, I have again illustrated this in following diagram, wherein a beam of neutron particles is coming out from an accelerator and falling out on a scatter. As the kinetic energy of the projectile beam or the particles can be controlled at this end, and these particles interact with each of the scattering centers, the scattering profile or the distribution can be collected by a detector. Such detector is attached with goniometer, and this can be drawn like this in this diagram. We can draw a detector. For example, this detector is connected over here. So if this is the axis of the beam, incident beam, so here you can get this detector that can gather all the scattered beam over here. Okay, so depending upon the theta, the number of particles coming into the detector will be different for different cases. The distribution of scattered beam is different for the different theta. For example, there will be a different particles coming out from the scatter center. So for this theta 1, you will have a different. For theta 2, you will have a different. Okay, it is also depend on the time. For example, if you have done an experiment for 5 minutes for a same theta, you will get a different profile of the scattered beam. And if you done the same experiment for 2 minutes, then the number of particles coming out from the scattering centers will be different. So obviously for the two minute experiment, the number of particles coming into the detector will be less as compared to the 5 minute experiment. So I can write that the number of particles coming into the detector can depends on the time t. Okay, another important aspect of the dependency of the number of particle is the solid angle suspended by the detector on the target point where the scattering takes place. You can see if the position of the detector is different, for this is, let us say this is a solid angle d of omega. So when the detector is over here, or when the detector is somewhere far away from this scattering point, so you can see, so depending upon this solid angle d omega, the profile of the scattered beam will be different. So the another quantity we can write, that is influencing the number of particles coming into the detector, is d of omega. The number of particles collected by detector is also depends on the incident flux. That means how many particles are on shine on a target material. So this gathering of number of particles by a detector will also be influenced by the incident intensity of the incident beam of neutron. The fourth dependency of the number of particles gathered by a detector is also depends on the scattering centers. Okay, so how many scattering centers are there, those are available for the scattering process, so those number will also influence the number of scattered particles. So the fourth quantity will be the NT, which is the number of scattering centers. So altogether, if combine all these four quantities, we can write, therefore, the total number of particles collected in the detector will depends on the time t, that is the time taken during the experiment, solid angle d of omega. It also depends on the intensity of the particle beam, that is number of particle crossing per unit area per unit time I, and finally it also depends on the number of target particles available for the scattering processes. So thus this proportionality has some special arrangement over here. Basically, if we remove this proportionality and introduce a certain constant, that constant basically tells us a relationship between the projectile particle and the scattered particles that are coming during the scattering process. Now in previous equation, if we remove the proportionality over there and introduce a constant that is known as sigma theta phi, and this sigma theta phi basically takes the following form. Okay, this can be written as dn upon d of omega. Okay, and this sigma theta phi basically is known as a differential scattering cross section, and we can define this differential scattering cross section as the ratio of the number of particles n scattered into an element of solid angle d of omega per second per unit solid angle to the number of incident particles n per unit cross sectional area per second. Now in the present case, that is the case of neutron proton scattering, we will deduce the relationship for the differential cross sectional, that is sigma theta phi for neutron proton scattering, in terms of the phase shift in coming slides. Now let us begin with the theory of neutron proton scattering at low energies, where an intense and collimated beam of nucleon is bombarded on target nuclei. The reaction between incident nuclei and target nuclei take place. As a result, we may observe the following two possibilities. One, that is the interaction do not changes the incident particle, that is incoming and outgoing particles both are the same. The change is in the path of the incoming nucleons, that is they are deviated from their original path, but the particle remains the same. Okay, this process is known as the scattering, as we just discussed. In a scattering process, the outgoing particle may have the same energy as that of the incident particle, or may have the change in their energy's values. Okay, the former is known as a elastic scattering, and the latter is known as a incident inelastic scattering scattering. Okay, the second possibility is that the outgoing particle are different from the incident particle, that is then the interaction process is known as a nuclear reaction. In nuclear reaction, we have alternatives such as radiative captures, gamma ray radiation, etc. In fact, it has been witnessed that this radiative capture has low probability. Therefore, so the most of the probable state is scattering at first place. Among the nucleon-nucleon scattering, neutron-proton scattering is the simplest one that we are going to discuss here, because here the complications due to Coulomb forces are not present. It is purely a scattering process. In particular, in the experiment, a beam of neutron from an accelerator is allowed to impinge on a target containing many essential free protons. The simplest substance is hydrogen gas. We can take hydrogen gas as a target material. In some cases, other substances like thin nylon sheet or any other target materials were also used. Therefore, we require free protons to get scattered with neutron. However, it is natural to think that in target material, the protons are not free but bound in molecule. But the molecular winding energy is so small, that is just about 1 electron volt. Therefore, for impinging, neutrons of energy greater than 1 electron volt will be required. And so this is very simple. To knock out such protons, we need to provide the energy greater than the 1 electron volt. So, and the proton can be regarded as free now. Therefore, this condition will be a minimum requirement for a neutron-proton scattering to take place in substance like hydrogen or any other. The neutron-proton scattering cross-section has been examined extensively, experimentally, as well as the theoretically, both at low energies and at high energies. At low energy below 10 mega electron volt, the scattering is essentially due to neutron having zero angular momentum, that is the L, the quantum number L is zero, and hence in the center of mass system, the angular distribution of scattering neutron is isotropic. So in the present case, we will discuss the neutron-proton scattering when the angular momentum L is zero state. So moving further. Now let us begin with mathematically to address the neutron-proton scattering mathematically. For this, we need to write a Schrödinger equation, as we write in most of the cases, with considering a central force potential. I wish to make a comment over here that the Schrödinger equation is the wave equation which expresses the wave function psi of the matter wave in different physical conditions. Here the Schrödinger equation for a central potential Vr is given by this equation. So this is a Schrödinger wave equation. Okay, this is written over here. Here m is the reduced mass of the neutron-proton scattering. Okay, and E is the incident kinetic energy, and Vr is the internuclear potential energy. So that can be understood with the help of potential well diagram. We can think of two regions. Region 1, that is, this is region 1, you can write this, this is region 1, okay, and the region 2, this is region 2. Let me write over, this is R0, this is again R, and this is a potential V. Here you can write is 0, and this is minus of V0. Okay, so here we have two regions, region 1. Region 1 belongs to the incident particle. Okay, this is incident particle for the region 1, and the region 2 belongs to where the incident particle beam faces a potential. This potential is faced by an incident beam over here by the target protons. Now when the particle beam faces the potential, then there will be a phase shift delta in the wave function. Now calculate this delta. This delta, that is the phase shift. Now calculate this delta by solving this potential equation. From this, you will get a sigma, that is the differential cross section. This is what we are looking for in this exercise. So we will later define a delta in terms of sigma. So there will be a relationship between sigma and delta. By solving this Schrödinger equation, we will get phase shift and then accordingly cross sectional area. Moving further, Now moving further, in quantum physics, you can determine the radial part of a wave function when you work on a problem that have a central potential or any other kind of potential. With the central potential problem, you are able to separate the wave function into a radial part, which essentially depends on the form of the potential, and an angular part, which is a spherical in harmonic. You can give the radial part of the wave function name, like for example, we can write the radial part as a R NL R. Okay, this is a radial part of the wave function, where N is the quantum number corresponding to the quantum state of the radial part of the wave function, and L is the total angular momentum. Okay, so here this is our radial part. We can give this equation 1, okay, and this is equation 2, which represents the wave function psi in the original Schrödinger equation, and here k is wave number, and that can be written like this. Okay, to analyze the scattering event, we have to solve this equation under proper conditions. So we need to solve this equation. Okay, here our target is to first consider a proper wave function that can capture the neutron proton scattering in general. So we will solve this equation in next step. For the scattering condition, we can impose certain boundary conditions, or we can imply some boundary conditions that can describe our wave function properly. For example, for the large distance from the scattering center, the wave should be made up of two parts. One is an incident plane wave, okay, that describes the unscattered particle and superimpose on it, and the other is outgoing scattered spherical wave, okay, which essentially represent the scattering, the wave after the scattering centers. Okay, so the wave function total psi can have a two part. One is the incident and the other is the scattering function. Okay, so the incident wave plane that can have the following kind of nature, that is e to the power iota k dot r, or it can be also write I k r cos theta. On the other hand, the scattering wave will have f theta e to the power I k r upon r, and if we combine these two, the total wave function will have an incident as well as the scattering part of both of the things. For large value of r, the function f theta, this function f theta represents the amplitude of the scatter wave in the direction theta. So this wave function is necessarily consequences of the assumption that the scatter simply scatter the particle and does not absorb them at all. So it is a purely scattering phenomena that is going to take place, and there is no such any kind of absorption of the energy or anything in the present case. So if we are able to represent this f of theta in terms of sigma, that was the cross-sectional, okay, and if we represent that sigma again in terms of the delta, so we will be able to address the neutron proton scattering in a complete way. Now this wave function psi, and with the help of the other equation that we just passed away from the previous slide, so this wave function further can be expanded in terms of Legendre polynomial. Okay, this Legendre polynomial already we have seen in mathematical physics, wherein you can define how to define this Legendre polynomial and how to solve it further. Okay, so based on those experience, we can apply those over here, and finally we can write our wave function psi theta of r in terms of Legendre polynomial, where this function fl or f theta, basically this f theta is representing the amplitude of the scattering wave, and the another function is jlkr, and this is basically a Bessel function, a spherical Bessel function. So we can give this equation 1, this equation 2, and this equation 3 for present case. Okay, so if somehow we are able to express this f theta, that is the scattering amplitude, in terms of delta, delta is the phase shift, and further this delta in terms of scattering cross section sigma, theta and phi. So with the help of these three parameters, that is f theta and delta and sigma theta phi, we will be able to address the neutron proton scattering at low energies. Okay. So further for solving this equation, we need to adopt the limiting case wherein the solution of this equation should lies when r is very large, that is infinity. Such a limiting case is known as a asymptotic behavior of equation. So let us first discuss what is asymptotic relation. Let me define here the asymptotic behavior of a function. Here I have taken a function 1 upon x and it is plotted. This is x and this is y over here. You can see when x or y approaching x or y approaching towards the infinity, then the behavior of curve can be seen over here. So in such a case, when x or y is tends to approach infinity, but it never reaches to ultimate value of infinity, such behavior is known as a asymptotic behavior of a function. So in mathematics, sometime or the many time we used to express the limits x tends to 0 or x tends to infinity. In physics, when we discuss these terms in terms of the limit, then we express or we describe this limit in terms of asymptotic behavior of a function. So we can understand that how this function will behave when x tends to infinity or y tends to infinity. So the same way that is we have adopted over here in the present case, when our r is approaching towards the infinity, how f theta will have the final form. Now in the asymptotic region where r tends to infinity, when we solve the previous f theta equation with the help of limiting case r tends to infinity, this f theta will take this form, this equation 1. Here we have done certain mathematics and applied the boundary condition when r tends to infinity. So this f theta can be represented in terms of delta. This delta is known as a phase shift. Basically, this phase shift is coming when you have an incident wave. And when this incident wave scattered with the scatterer, so there will be a phase shift. So again, the amplitude of the scattered wave is expressed in terms of phase shift. If we are able to evaluate this phase shift, this will allow to determine the differential cross section. Again, let me define the differential cross section. And it is defined as the ratio of the number of particle capital N scattered into an element of the solid angle del d omega per second per solid angle to the number of incident particle N per unit cross sectional area per second. So you can see that f theta is indicate the amplitude of the scattering wave in the direction of theta. So again, if you take the mod of f theta square, this will give you a cross sectional, differential cross sectional. Okay, and this differential cross section is further represented in terms of delta. Oh, that this is the relation for what we are looking over here. Further, if we define this differential cross section in terms of the total cross section, then from the previous equation of d sigma upon d omega, it is possible to get the total scattering cross section sigma. If we integrate this equation over entire solid angle, that is omega, so if this is a d of omega and if we integrate it for entire omega, then we can get a sigma. And in the present case, this is the equation for the total scattering cross section, that is 4 pi upon k square summation over l equals to 0 to infinity twice l plus 1 sine square delta L. Here L is the angular momentum, the quantum number, and delta is the phase shift that we have already discussed in our previous slide. Okay, in general, if delta sigma upon delta omega varies with direction over the surface of the sphere, so you can consider this surface like this. So if you get the integral over entire surface, then in that case, when delta 0 is a special phase shift, then delta sigma upon delta omega is constant and comes out from the integral. Okay, so in such a case, the calculated or the estimated value of scattering cross section sigma will be pi r square upon q square sine square delta omega. Now, if with the help of our potential that we have taken from the starting of the Schrödinger wave equation, writing the Schrödinger wave equation, and if we impose such boundary conditions, then the sigma calculated will be sigma calculated in the present case will be 5 Bern. Okay. So the Bern is one Bern is defined as 10 raised to power minus 28 meter square. So the calculated maximum value of 5 Bern. Even if we change the potential, for example, instead of taking a central potential or instead of taking a square value potential, we take some other another potential, in that case also the calculated sigma will be around 4 to 5 Bern only. Okay, so that is the total. Now it remains to check this calculated value with the experimental value. So in next slide we will see how we can compare with the experimental value. Now our calculated sigma, that is around 5 Bern, if we compare this calculated value with the experimental data, so we can have something different story for neutron proton scattering. So you can see this is experimental data taken from the Review of Modern Physics published in 1950. So you can see here we the authors have represented the sigma scattering cross section on y-axis and the neutron kinetic energy on the x-axis. Okay, so this sigma is in the unit of Bern and kinetic energy is in the unit of electron volt. So you can see up to here the experimental value of scattering cross section is about 20 Bern. So and you can also see this range is a low energy range. This is 100 electron volt, this is 1 kilo electron volt, and so on. So you can see from this graph that at low energy up to this energy level, this range of energy, the experimental value of cross section scattering cross section is around 20 Bern. However, if we further move the kinetic energy of the incident particle, then this scattering cross section is reduces drastically. So there are a large difference between the experimental value and the calculated value. So as already we have seen, sigma calculated was 5 Bern, and sigma experimental is about 20 Bern. So there is a large discrepancy in between the calculated and the experimental value. So it remains to check what are the reason behind such deviation of the calculated value from the experimental value. That we can understand with the help of the force acting on the neutron proton during the scattering. At the outset of this results, it can be concluded that the calculated value of sigma are underestimated with this treatment of the problem. Okay, so it signifies that if we that means we have missed something big in the consideration of our interaction potential between neutron and proton. So what will be the solution for it to get this calculated value closer to the experimental value? So this was discussed in 1935 by Wigner, and that is now coming to the last part of the lecture, that is spin dependence of the neutron proton scattering. So in 1935, Wigner suggested that the inter nuclear forces are basically spin dependent. That is seen in the neutron case, where you will have a neutron and proton both coexist in a triplet and singlet state. So if we write the total scattering cross section sigma 0 with 3 by 2 sigma t 0 and 1 by 4 sigma s 0, here sigma t 0 and sigma s 0 as the scattering cross section from the triplet state and scattering cross section from the singlet state, and 3 by 4 and 1 by 4 is the statistical weight average of both the scattering process. And if we calculate sigma t 0, that sigma t 0 comes out to be 2 to 3 burn, while to that sigma s 0 is comes out to be 66 to 74 burn. So with the help of these two parameters, we can get the total sigma 0, and sigma calculated will be comes around 21, which is almost equal to the experimental value. Experimental value sigma experimental is also around 21. So if we consider the spin dependency of the neutron proton in the scattering, then we are able to get the calculated sigma as compared to experimental value. So if I go from the beginning of the today's lecture, so I can just wind up with the following steps. That first we have taken this neutron proton scattering at low energy. This low energy can be only be taken when the L is zero. That is, the angular quantum number L should be zero, L equals to zero. So with that hypothesis, we first establish a Schrödinger wave equation. First we have write that equation and solve it. While solving it, we were able to get f theta. This f theta is related to the scattering amplitude of the neutron proton beam. Neutron beam. Okay, so with help of this scattering neutron proton scattering, we were able to establish a relationship between scattering cross section and the amplitude, and this amplitude turn out to be in terms of delta, which is phase shift. So while calculating with our potential that we have taken in the initial state, so the calculated sigma comes around 20 burns, and was comes around 5 burns only, while the experimental value was around 21. So what was the reason behind such discrepancy in the calculated and experimental? That was rectified by Wigner in 1935 with the consideration that the neutron proton scattering is basically spin dependent. So over here I am going to conclude my today's lecture. At the end, while preparing this lecture, I have taken the help from the following books. First is Introductory Nuclear Physics. This is written by Kenneth S. Crane in 1988. And the second book is Concepts of Nuclear Physics by Cohen. It is from 1977. And the other book is Nuclear Physics Theory and Experiment, written by R.R. Roy and B.P. Nigam. And there are few lectures on NPTEL given by Professor S.C. Burman. So we can get the help from these books to understand the neutron-proton scattering at low energies, and also the other scattering process such as the proton-proton scattering or any other scattering. While understanding the neutron proton scattering at low energies, I would suggest these two questions to be answered by students who are looking or who is watching this video. So they should write short note on following two questions. One is, why is the deuteron binding energy different from H square upon ma square, where As is the scattering length. The other question is, which S wave contribute to neutron proton scattering. So I would suggest students to write on short notes on these two questions. Thank you for watching this video and understanding the neutron proton scattering at low energies.